Well, welcome back, and thank you for during the break convincing me I didn't have all those symptoms because I was really worried. I can feel my pants getting tighter as I was sitting here. Let's talk about the process of it, because I think most people, it's a, as you said earlier, it's kind of the last effort for them to try to make a big difference in their life. Secondly, it's sometimes by some health plans an elective surgery, and sometimes it's not. So kind of explain for the qualification, if you will, other than the desire to have it done and mm-hmm. how you can be elected or not elected as far as your health plan.
There are very strict qualifications, medical qualifications, that make you a candidate for this surgery.
And so it's not totally elective. You have to be qualified
physically. Yeah. Absolutely. It's based on the body mass index, which is a measurement of your height in combination with your weight that really determines how you're carrying your weight. Generally, it's a body mass index of 40 or more, which is generally a person who's about 100 pounds overweight, or someone who's a little bit on the lighter side than that, with a body mass index of 35 to 40, with medical problems that are already creeping up and causing problems for that patient.
Diabetes or heart problems.
Diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, cholesterol, that sort of thing. And right now, it's inappropriate, basically considered malpractice, to perform gastric bypass on someone with a BMI less than 35. So that really leaves a large chunk of our population, maybe between 20 and 80 pounds overweight, really in the lurch, having to deal with diets because they don't qualify for the surgery. A lot of my patients feel like they're lucky because they were heavy enough to qualify for the surgery. Now, those are the medical qualifications.
Lucky, that's kind of an interesting area. Yeah, go ahead.
They frequently have family members who don't qualify because they're only 50 pounds overweight, and those are the people who are really stuck. But those are the medical qualifications. That, unfortunately, doesn't have anything to do with your insurance company.
Right.
Now, those are the NIH consensus panel recommendations. So that's what the NIH is recommending to the insurance companies to use as a guideline to authorize someone to have the surgery or to pay for their surgery. They've been telling the insurance companies who to reimburse, but the insurance companies aren't legally obligated to adhere to those recommendations.
Right.
So especially the HMOs, which are very interested in cost cutting, won't authorize people to have the surgery sometimes under any circumstances, and sometimes not until they're very, very sick.
And then sometimes it's not the best posture. The person's physical well-being, while it's in danger, is not really, I mean, it's not an easy surgery to go through, I'm assuming.
No,
it's not.
And so
if they're on the cusp of going down instead of, you know, remaining neutral or feeling okay, it's more serious an operation, I'm guessing.
They're higher risk for the operation, but on the other side of the coin, they're going to die if they don't get the operation. And that's really where the tire meets the road for a lot of people. They
yeah.
realize that they're going to die without the operation. And the research actually shows us that if you're about 100 pounds overweight or more, you're 10 times more likely to die in the next 5 years if you don't have the surgery versus if you have the surgery. And that's been a very good research study that has come out recently, and that's very important for people to know to make an informed decision about this.
So the ultimate outcome of the surgery when it's done and successful and all that sort of stuff is they just have the capacity to eat less?
They eat less, they're able to lose weight very quickly, so they can exercise and really live a healthy lifestyle overall. It isn't just a matter of eating less, but it is a matter of living a healthy life and exercising like we all should exercise.
And the process does what? It reduces the size of the stomach? It reduces, how does that?
It does a couple of things. It makes the stomach very small, to about the size of a golf ball, and then a piece of small intestine is attached to that tiny little stomach. And there are a couple of reasons why we do it that way. Number one, the small little stomach limits the amount of food that a person can take in.
Even though it can stretch some.
The small little stomach, if you make it properly, won't stretch.
Oh.
Because it's made with a part of the stomach that isn't distensible. So if you do the surgery properly, you have a very tiny little stomach that won't stretch out over time. The idea is that the food goes into that little stomach and people feel full in their stomach, but your head isn't done craving yet.
But it really tasted good.
Full. It continues to taste good. That's right. You don't get the signal for satiety or really mentally feeling like you're done with the food until it passes into the small intestine. And the interesting thing about this surgery is that the food passes directly from the tiny little stomach into the small intestine. So within minutes, the patients get a signal back to their brain indicating that they're full and they're satisfied.
Boy, that was great. What's next?
And they feel like they've just eaten a huge turkey dinner and they don't desire food anymore.
Now, okay, so does that have to be balanced then with the vitamins? I mean, how do they supplant the ability to get the kind of nourishment they need?
Interestingly, most patients who qualify for this surgery could live on a desert island for about a year with water and a couple of vitamins and be fine because they have enough energy in the form of fat on their body to supply the body with the energy that it needs to live. The only thing you really need to supply from the outside is protein and a couple of vitamins. So my patients do take vitamin supplements every day, not typically because they can't absorb the vitamins from their food, but they're limited in the amount that they can eat, so they might not necessarily meet their recommended daily requirements.